All right, welcome to the Berean Bible Fellowship. Happy Mother's Day to all mothers. Today is May 8th. I just wanted to start off, if we could all keep Tiffany's family in prayer. We know that the recent loss that they had, let's keep them in prayer. And as I said, utilize this time to think about when you're considering talking to somebody about Christ. And sometimes we're a little bit hesitant in speaking to friends and family, but we never know when God is going to call someone home or their life on this earth is over. And once somebody is gone and they've left this life, the verdict is now in. It's too late to change your mind. The debate is over. The verdict is in. And the question is, what think ye of Christ? Did you believe that he was God, or did you not? Did you have faith? Did you not? It's, when someone's gone, it's now too late. Today, we're going to be, let's first start off in prayer. Bow your heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you and give you praise. Father, we want to thank you for all the blessings that you've put into our lives. Father, we want to thank you that we are all believers here, and that when that hour comes and that you call us home, Father, that we have an eternity with you to look forward to. Father, we ask that you open our hearts and minds today and help us to receive the word that you've prepared for us. Help us to apply it in each and every one of our days, in our lives. Help us to be more godly people and help us to spread your gospel. Father, we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Today we're going to be embarking on quite a study. This should be a series of about 7 sermons where we're going over God's plan for the ages. Now, God's plan for salvation of man was created in eternity past, before creation. The love and mercy of God is beyond the understanding of man. Why were we created? Why did God allow sin into the world? Man has struggled with questions from the beginning of time. Over the next several weeks, we will walk through the ages and look at the different dispensations that God has divided human history into. Through this view, we will look at how God has judged man and how in each dispensation, God shows mankind that we need a Savior. Now, a dispensation is defined as a certain order, a system, or an arrangement, administration, or management. For this series of sermons, we're going to recognize these 7 distinct dispensations. Within each dispensation is a trial where God shows man that he needs a Savior. The first one is the age of innocence. Next is the age of conscience. Next, the age of human government. Fourth, the age of promise, which is from Abraham to Sinai. 5 is the law, from Sinai to Christ. 6, the age of grace. 7, the millennium. So, to start at the beginning, we must first recognize that which has no beginning. The triune God is eternal. And when I say triune God, that's just meaning that you have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Before anything existed, God was. God has no beginning. He has no creator. There are 4 things that are eternal, beings or plans. And they are, the first one is in Deuteronomy 33-27. The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. And he shall thrust out the enemy from before thee, and shall say, destroy them. So first, God the Father is eternal. He always was. Second, we look into John 1:1-2. You don't need to turn to those. We're going to go past those ones. And it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. So it's saying the Word was there. In the beginning, the Word was there. The Word was not created. He was there. In John 1:14 it says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now, when it says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, who is that? That is Jesus Christ. That is talking about the humanity of Christ. Here we see the hypostatic union. Jesus Christ was not always, He did not always have human form. In eternity past, He was just the Word. He was just God. And then He took on the form of a human being and walked among us. Okay? And then in Hebrews 9:14 it says, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? So the Spirit was eternal. So now you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Those three were eternal, meaning no beginning, no end. And now the fourth thing is kind of interesting. It says in Ephesians 3:11, according to the eternal purpose which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. So the fourth thing that is eternal, that has no beginning, has no end, is God's plan for man. And that's interesting, that throughout all eternity, just as God is eternal, also, so was His plan for mankind. Always eternal, had no beginning. So that means the entire time that God is, which is eternal, He planned for what would happen with man. Okay? So now we're going to look at the original creation. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to Genesis chapter 1. Easy to find, right in the beginning. We're going to be looking at verse 1 and 2. Now it says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Verse 2. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Now, many biblical scholars believe that there was a significant period of time between verse 1 and verse 2. It is believed that the original creation of the earth was like everything else that God had created, beautiful and productive, and that an event happened that caused the earth to become void and desolate. If you look in Isaiah, don't turn, in Isaiah 45:18 it says, for thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God Himself that formed the earth and made it, He hath established it and created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else. So what is it saying there? It's saying that original creation in verse 1, God created the heavens and earth. He created the earth to be beautiful, to be productive, to be inhabited. He did not create it void and ugly and dark. And if you sit there and you read those two verses as one thought, and that has been the basic thought that we have had throughout the years, you're reading that as one complete thought instead of splitting it in half, understanding that there was a gap in between there. And we're going to investigate this a little bit further. And what is believed? It is believed that the fall of Lucifer is what caused the desolation of the original earth. And through this fall, Lucifer became Satan. Remember, Satan was already in his fallen state when he was in the Garden of Eden. And if we look to it, and go ahead and turn your Bibles here to Ezekiel 28, it gives an account of Lucifer's fall. Ezekiel is in the Old Testament. It's towards the middle end of the Old Testament. And in this verse, the Lord is talking through Ezekiel, and Ezekiel is talking or addressing the king of the prince of Tyrus. The prince of Tyrus was a very wicked leader, and it was believed that that he was actually inhabited by Satan. In the first half of this address, you can tell that he's speaking to a man. But in the second half, he's talking to Lucifer, and he's reminding Lucifer of what happened during his fall. We all at Ezekiel? Ezekiel 28. We all got it? Okay. We're starting right at verse 1. And it says, "The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, Thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God. I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas, yet thou art a man, and not God. Though thou set thine heart as the heart of God, behold, thou art wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that they can hide from thee. With thy wisdom and with thine understanding, thou hast gotten thee riches, and hast gotten gold and silver into thy treasures. But thy great wisdom and by thy traffic hast thou increased thy riches, and thine heart is lifted up because of thy riches. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, because thou hast set thine heart as the heart of God, behold, therefore I will bring strangers upon thee, the terrible of the nations, and they shall draw their swords against the beauty of thy wisdom. And thou shalt defile thy brightness. They shall bring thee down into the pit, and thou shalt die the death of them that are slain in the midst of the seas. Wilt thou yet say before him that slay thee, I am God? But thou shalt be a man and no God. In the hand of him that slayeth thee, thou shalt die the death of the uncircumcised by the hand of strangers. For I have spoken it, saith the Lord God. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying..." Now here's where he switches, and you can tell now that he's not talking to a man. He's talking to Satan. "Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, Thou sealest us the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold in the workmanship of thy tabrets, and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stone of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude, thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee. O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire, thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings, that they may behold thee. Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thine iniquities. By thy iniquity of thy traffic, therefore, I will bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to the ashes upon the earth, in the sight of all of them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be any more. So here, this is where, see, he's referencing here when Satan was thrown down. When Satan rose up against God, and he and his demons were defeated, and they were thrown down to the earth. And the earth became scorched and burnt and void. So when we get to Genesis 1:2, God is now renovating the earth that had become void and dark. The Spirit of God moved on the face of the waters. God's six-day creation has been a subject of much controversy. Many people believe that God's day could be 1,000 years. I'm sure you've all heard that before. They said, well, God, one day to God could be 1,000 years to man. But many, many people, and even including Pope Francis, he states that God's creation was accomplished through evolution. But what does the Word of God state concerning this? In Genesis 1:2-5, God gives account, his account of the first day. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. So God clearly here defines what a day is. That is, you had the evening, you had the morning, that was a day. Not 1,000 years, not 1,000,000 years. He clearly defines that he's talking about a lunar day. So this proves that the evolutionist theory of millions of years of creation is false. God in Genesis 1:26 says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Genesis 2:7, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Satan was given authority over the earth that had become void and dark. His jealousy was stirred when God gave authority to this new creation called man. Here we enter the age of innocence. Now God created man and gave him dominion over all else that he created. God placed man in perfect environment. Man had everything that he needed. He had food, he had shelter, he had everything, he had perfect fellowship with God. Because God created man in his image, man had free will. In order to have free will, you must be able to exercise it. A good example would be if I sit there and I tell you, okay, the only thing I don't want you to do is I don't want you to go outside. But I sit here and I bolt all the windows and doors. Do you have free will? Are you truly obeying me? No, because you don't have the opportunity to disobey. So God had to have. And to be a just God and to be a God of integrity, there had to be a way for man to disobey him. Okay? And the reason this is called the Age of Innocence is because God only wanted man to understand good. He did not want him to understand evil. Okay. Now, had man sat here and not eaten of the fruit, then man would have shown himself righteous, because he was not yet in a sinful state. So God instructed man that he may eat of any tree in the garden except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Satan tempts Eve and deceives her into sin. Eve gives the forbidden fruit to Adam. Adam makes a conscious decision to disobey God. Turn in your Bibles to Genesis 3, chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. Chapter 3. Okay. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eye, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. So, this was the fall of man. What consequences did we have from this? Now, Satan led man to choose his lie over God's truth. And this is what Satan always does, and is more effective when you're gonna lie to somebody. It's always a little bit more effective to mix it with a little bit of truth. It's kind of like baiting a hook. When you put a worm on there, you gotta have something that somebody wants on there. How many fishermen do you see that they just throw their pole out there with a hook on there, and there's nothing to attract the fish? Do any fish just come along and say, hey, there's a hook, let me bite it? No. There's got to be something there that they desire. And this is what Satan did. He put something out there that Eve desired. He said, you will become as gods. Your eyes will be opened. You will be just like him. Guess what he's telling you? God is holding out on you. He didn't give you everything you needed. He didn't give you the knowledge here of evil. This knowledge of evil is a good thing, by the way. This is what Satan is saying. So he gets her with that with truth. Now, not that it's truth that it's good, but truth that their eyes will be open. But then the lie is, you won't die. And that they did die. They died instantly. They died spiritually, and they lost fellowship with God. Another big result was innocence was removed. They now had their eyes open. And it says that, and he said, God was speaking to Adam, and he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree where I commanded thee that thou shouldst not eat? God, like a father, sits there and asks a question that he already has the answer to. Another thing that you could see that there was a change is a man now feared God. In Genesis 3, 8 through 9, it says, And God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. To where God, so where man wasn't afraid of God or didn't fear God before, now he feared him. So Adam and Eve here create a type of religion, and through the work of their hands, they try to make themselves acceptable to God. The fig leaves sewn together to cover themselves. Sin now separated God and man. But also, this is the first place where God promises a redeemer to them. In Genesis 3:15, it says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Now, when I was younger and I read this verse, I actually thought that it meant women were going to hate snakes. I thought this is what God was promising here. And if my wife was any judge of it, that's exactly what it means. But this verse has much more of a more complex meaning to it. So let's quickly break it down. In the first part of this verse, God states that he will put enmity between Satan and the woman, between her seed and him. What he was saying is Christ will come from the seed of a woman. This was the prophecy of a virgin birth, that from the woman's seed, the Savior will come. Notice here, the man is not involved. He didn't tell Adam that Christ would come from anything between him and the snake. He said between the enmity will be between the woman and the man. And it says, "It shall bruise thy head." The seed of the woman will crush and defeat Satan's world government. This is a prophecy of the future during the tribulation period. And it says, "Thou shalt bruise his heel." Satan will lead man to crucify the Messiah. So this is the first picture in Scripture that God is going to send a Redeemer. So God foreshadows his eternal plan for man. In Genesis 3:21, "Unto Adam also, and to his wife, did the Lord God make coats of skin and clothe them." God does the work. Blood must be shed. Salvation by grace. This foreshadows the Messiah coming and dying on the cross. Now, at the end of each dispensations, we will examine four areas. One, a new beginning. Two, sin. Three, failure. And four, judgment. So the renovation of the earth and the creation of man as a creature different from any other creation of God marked a new beginning. A creation made in the likeness of God with a spirit and placed in dominion over the earth. But Satan in his jealousy deceived Eve, and she and Adam fell in sin. Mankind had failed the trial of innocence. God only wanted man to understand what was good. But because man disobeyed God, their eyes were now open, and they now had to choose between good and evil. Finally, God judged Adam and Eve. In Genesis 3:22 through 24, it says, "And the Lord God said, Behold, the man has become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life, and eat and live forever, therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life." So this was the judgment that God pronounced. And if you look at the age of innocence as a trial that God has put man under, and seeing how could man save himself, given him that he has perfect innocence, he doesn't even know of evil, doesn't even know of it, and there's only one way for them to sin. Is man able to attain perfect righteousness? and not so much attain, is he able to sustain? Because at this point, God is innocent. I mean, man is innocent. He has no sin. He has perfect righteousness. Can he keep it? And what is the answer to the trial?
No.
No, it's not. No, he can't. So now God is going to move man unto another trial. Now we're going to move into the age of conscience. And that is where we'll pick up next week's sermon. We want to wish all the mothers that married a happy Mother's Day. And blessed is that, that the seed came through the woman. And we know this was necessary because sin was passed on through the man of the male of the race. So we honor our mothers, we cherish them, and we say thank you for all the sacrifices that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Mommy. Ashley. Thank you, Ashley.
Thank you, Wally. Thank you, Ashley.
Okay, let's close up in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Father, for all that you've been presented today. Father, help us to understand your will, moving man through the different trials of life of the ages, in each situation, showing that we need you as a Savior. We needed Jesus Christ to come down on the cross and pay for our sins, so that we can have perfect righteousness, so that we can stand in your presence eternally. Father, help us to understand, help us to intake the information and understand it, and seek out your truth. Father, we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Bring us back safely Thursday for Bible study, and for those who didn't make it today, please take care of them. We know that Bernardo was sick. Please be with them, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, all our prayers are asked. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.